The ANOVA test is analysis of variance. Variance will exist between groups, especially when one group is different than another. But there is also variance within each group, random variation that is just noise in the model. So ANOVA tells us if there is more signal than noise in that variance. So before we go further with ANOVA, let's learn some important definitions for the analysis of variance. An independent variable in ANOVA is called a factor. In fact, you will sometimes hear this called a factorial analysis of variance. One factor can have multiple levels or conditions. Each condition of the independent variable is called a level or treatment. If the factor is exercise, then the levels might be control group, no exercise, 2.5 hours of exercise per week, and 5 hours of exercise per week. If the factor was something about sleep, then the levels might be low, medium, and high levels of sleep. The symbol for the number of levels in a factor is K. The number of subjects in the factor is N, just like we've always used for sample size. Differences produced by the independent variable, such as the amount of exercise or the quantity of sleep, are called treatment effects and are revealed as the variance between. We do hypothesis testing with ANOVA in two steps. So first, we do the ANOVA, and then, if we find statistically significant results, we do a follow-up test. The reason for these two steps is that ANOVA is an omnibus test. Omnibus is something that comprises several items. An omnibus test comprises several comparisons. ANOVA tests for overall differences among multiple groups. ANOVA tells us that differences are here somewhere, but it will not tell us where those differences are. It tells us that group means differ, but not which means differ. To know which means differ, we must do a post hoc test. Post hoc is Latin meaning after. We will only do a post hoc test if the ANOVA is significant, and more on that in a moment. ANOVA is an F test, and it uses the F ratio, so called because it is named after British statistician and geneticist Sir Ronald Fisher. This is a picture of a plaque at his house. The F ratio is a measure of the variance between treatments, in the numerator, divided by the variance within treatments, in the denominator. A significant F ratio, or F value, tells us that the experiment was successful. The group means differ, but you still need to follow up with a post hoc. When comparing groups, there are two sources of variance, between and within. Variance between groups is due to actual treatment effects plus differences due to chance or error. If the high exercise group ended up being healthier than the no exercise control group, then there would be a difference between groups. Variance within groups is due only to chance or error. In the low sleep group, each person in the group would sleep for different amounts of time, and that is variability within the low sleep group. The F ratio is the variance between treatments divided by the variance within treatments. Now, because variance is a squared value, it is always positive. And because the F ratio divides two variances that are always positive, the F ratio itself will always be positive. The F ratio will tend to stack up around a value of 1, with fewer values as you move away from 1 to the right. So why do the values stack up around 1? Well, because if there's no effect from a treatment, then the only variability will be due to random chance. So when you divide the F ratio, you would be dividing random chance between by random chance within. In other words, anytime you divide something by itself, the value will be 1. So let's look at the F distribution. When all of the variability in your model is random noise, then dividing between by within will cancel out to 1. But when you start getting more variability between the groups, then the numerator will grow larger, and the ratio will start creeping out to the right, greater than 1. Values far from 1, beyond an F critical value that can be determined from the F table, will be statistically significantly different. In the shaded area, the area beyond alpha of 0.05, you would reject the null hypothesis that all of the groups are the same. So here are some examples of variance between and within. Shopping for jeans. The price of the jeans varies between stores, but also within a single store. Certain stores are more expensive and others are less expensive. That's variance between the stores. But within any given store, the price of the jeans will not be exactly the same. That price will differ for different pairs of jeans. That's variance within. Crops. The growth of crops varies between plots or fields and also within the plot. So not all of the corn plants in a given plot will be exactly the same height. That's variance within the plot. But the corn in the field that got fertilizer would grow better than the corn that got no fertilizer, and that would be variance between the plots. Or how about the temperature in your house? Are all of the rooms in your house the same temperature? The temperature varies between rooms, but it also varies within a room. So the basement would be cooler than the attic or the living room. That's variance between the rooms. But within the living room, the temperature within the room will vary from near the sunny picture window to over toward the middle of the room where it's cooler. So your dog might find the warmest spot of sunshine to take a nap in front of the picture window because it's just a little warmer there than elsewhere in the room. There's variation in the temperature within your room. Or radio station quality. Do you like all of the songs that are played on your favorite radio station? The quality of the songs is going to vary between stations, but also within the station that you're listening to. So this is why you have a favorite radio station, because you prefer the songs on that station to another type of station. That's variance between. But even within your favorite radio station, there are some songs you like better than others. That's variance within. If the Omnibus ANOVA test is significant and differences exist, you follow up with a post hoc test. Post hoc tests compare each individual mean against the other means. And the post hoc is necessary whenever you reject the null hypothesis and there are 3 or more groups. You would not do a post hoc test if the ANOVA was not significant, because there are no differences to find. Nor would you need a post hoc when you're comparing only 2 groups. If a t-test is significant, you can just look at the 2 group means and see which one is higher. But when you have 3 or more groups, you need a way to tell which means are different from which other means. Post hoc tests use a stricter criterion to accept an effect as significant. Hence, they control for family-wise error rate. They control for the increased likelihood of type 1 errors that occurs when you do multiple comparisons on the same data with a t-test. The simplest example of a post hoc is the Bonferroni method, in which you divide alpha by the number of groups. So if you have 3 groups with an alpha of 0.05, then your alpha level for the post hoc is 0.05 divided by 3, or 0.017. For 4 comparisons, it is 0.0125. For 5 comparisons with an alpha of 0.05, then your alpha level for the post hoc is 0.01. Now, the Bonferroni method is simple, but it's also excessively conservative, and that's bad too. It increases the likelihood of making type 2 errors, missing effects that really exist because it tightens up the decision-making criteria so much. Another alternative, however, is Tukey's Honestly Significant Difference Post Hoc Test. Tukey's Honestly Significant Difference Test tells us how far apart the means must be in order to be truly significant. This is the post hoc test that we will use in this example. It's a very good test, but it requires that the sample sizes be equal. If your sample sizes are not equal, you still have plenty of options. SPSS has 18 different types of post hoc tests. Each one is used when certain criteria exist or when certain assumptions are unmet in the ANOVA. We will use Tukey's Honestly Significant Difference post hoc test for this example. And remember, it's pronounced Tukey, not Turkey. Well, let's use a simple comparison to illustrate the elements of the ANOVA. In this example, we're asking the question, does type of diet affect weight loss? We have 20 randomly selected people who have been randomly assigned to four groups. Each group uses a different diet approach. So here we have one factor, which is diet. The one factor has four treatments or levels. The type of diet, willpower, paleo diet, Mediterranean, and vegan. Any differences in the scores within a group is variance within. Variance within is due to chance. People lose different amounts of weights within each type of diet. The differences in the overall amount of weight loss for each group represents variance between. Variance between the groups is accounted for by the random variation within, plus variance due to the treatment. Another way to think about this would be to consider that because all of the scores differ from each other, we have a total amount of variance within the model. That total amount of variance is made up of variance within, which is caused by chance within each group, and that total variance also comprises variance between the scores for each group. This is the variance between. We will divide the variance between by the variance within, canceling out the element of chance, leaving us with a ratio that reflects the size of the treatment effect. That is our F ratio or F value. And so with that introduction as to why we are doing ANOVA, we are ready to talk about the assumptions and the hypotheses for the one-way ANOVA.